Hebrews chapter 12, I will start reading here verse 14, and I'm going to read down a few verses of scripture. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 14, it says, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Then it says, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For you know how that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. Praise God. Father, we thank you for the word of truth, the gospel of our salvation. The word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our pathway. Open up our understanding that we might understand the scriptures, and we will praise you unconditionally in the name of your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, Yahshua, the Messiah of Israel. Praise God. Again, we're coming out of Hebrews chapter 12. We just read to you verse 14 through verse 17. Praise God. If you go down to verse 16, the Bible references a man named Esau. Praise God. Esau was the twin brother of Jacob. Amen. When they were conceived in their mother's womb, the Bible testifies, you can go back and read the account in Genesis chapter 24, chapter 25. The Bible says that when their mother was carrying them, the scripture says that there were two nations in her womb. Praise God. Now you got to remember, in the Hebrew world, the firstborn was the one that received the inheritance. Praise God. But the Bible says that when Esau and Jacob were about to be conceived, Esau was coming out the womb and Jacob grabbed his heel. And the reason Jacob grabbed his heel is so that he can pull him back in the womb, so that he himself can be birthed first, so that he might receive the inheritance. Praise God. But of course, the Bible shows us that Esau was the firstborn. Though him and his brother Jacob were twins. Praise God. Because Esau came out first, he received the birthright and became the one that received the inheritance. But you know the story, praise God, how that when they both had grew up some, Esau became a hunter. Amen. And while he was out there hunting, he became very hungry. And wouldn't you know it, that while he became very hungry, his brother Jacob was over there cooking. Amen. And Esau became so hungry, even to the point he was willing to sell his birthright, because he said, what good is a birthright if I'm dead? Hello? Amen. Amen. You ever heard people say, I'm starving to death? Well, Esau thought he was starving to death, even to the point he was willing to negotiate with his twin brother Jacob to
here how Esau, for one morsel of meat, he sold his birthright. Praise God. Now, do you not know the reason why the Hebrew writer put this in here? Because this is going on every day within the Christian church. People are selling their birthright. And I come to tell you that when you are a born-again believer, you possess a birthright, not because you're the firstborn of anything, but Jesus Christ, the Bible teaches us in Colossians chapter 1, that he is the firstborn from the dead. And when you are in Christ, you become a joint heir with him and an heir of God. Amen. Hello? Amen. So we become a partaker of his inheritance. Come on, somebody. Amen. As being sons of the Most High God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. But when you know it today that many people are selling their birthright, they have planted signs outside of their life, and they are advertising that they are for rent, and in most cases, they are for sale. Hello? Amen. Praise God. Many are selling Jesus out. Sort of what Judas did over in Luke chapter 22, verses 1 through verse 6. How many remember the story of Judas?
Amen.
When he, praise God, left the Passover meal and went to betray the Son of Man. The Bible teaches us here in verse 1 of Luke chapter 22, it said, "Now the feast of unleavened bread drew nigh, which is called the Passover, and the chief priests and scribes sought how they might kill him." Look at that. See, there's always a plot going on against the church. If they plotted against Jesus Christ, they definitely are plotting to destroy the church. Praise God. And no matter how much the devil plot against the church, Jesus has already prophesied in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 16 that the gates of hell shall not prevail against his church. Praise God. Amen. But the text goes on to read here in Luke chapter 22 and verse 2. It says that the chief priests and scribes sought how they might kill him, for they feared the people. Praise God. Did you see that?
Amen.
They feared the people. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And verse 3 says, "Then entered Satan into Judas, surnamed Iscariot, being of the number of the 12. And he went his way and communed with the chief priests and captains how he might betray him unto them." Did you see that? What did Judas do? He went and communed with the chief priests and the captains how they might betray the Son of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Didn't the Bible teach us in 1 Corinthians 15 that evil communication corrupt good manners?
Amen.
Now we know the text teaches us how Satan had already entered into Judas. And what did he do? He went and yoked up with these chief priests who were Hebrews and these captains which were Hebrews how they might betray Jesus Christ. Praise God. This is why you got to be watchful of the religious crowd today. Come on. It's a difference between true saints of God and people that are just full of religion. Come on.
Amen.
And the chief priests and the captains, even though they were Hebrews, they were full of dead religion. Glory to God. And the text goes on to say here in verse 5, "And they were glad." Look at that. "And covenanted to give him money." Glory to God. "And he promised and sought opportunity to betray him unto them in the absence of the multitude." Praise God. Did you see that? Amen. What happened? Judas sold Jesus out. He sold him out for 30 pieces of silver. Amen. Now, many people like to talk about what Judas did, but how many people really consider themselves? What are you selling Jesus out for? And I come to tell you, the reason why the devil continues to tempt people as much as he do, you know what he's doing? He's trying to find the right price that you are willing to accept in order to sell Jesus out. Come on. Look at Jesus in the wilderness of temptation. Did not Satan tempt him? Time after time after time, he continued to tempt him. Pray God. Why? Because he was trying to find the right price that Jesus would accept in order to bow down and worship him and ultimately turn his back on his Father, which is in heaven. That's why the devil never stops, because he's discovered something. That everybody has a price. Look at that.
Amen.
Everybody has a price. Glory to God. If you offer somebody the right price, they will sell it out. Come on.
Amen.
Hallelujah. But see, you got to get to that place in your life where you are not for rent.
Amen.
And you're not for sale.
Amen.
Come on. Did you not know that when something has become priceless, you are not willing to sell it? Hello, somebody. But the reason why people are willing to sell Jesus out, because he is not worth it. Come on. He has no worth to them. He's not a pearl of great price to them. That's why they're willing to sell him out so easily. Glory to God. He means nothing to them. Praise God. And that's why you see people sell Jesus out for all kinds of things. People still sell Jesus out for food today.
Amen.
Come on. Just like the children of Israel, whom God delivered out of the house of bondage, which we know to be called Egypt. The Bible says even after God delivered them out of Egypt by the hand of the prophet Moses, they desired to go back to Egypt because they felt that when they was in Egypt, they ate better.
Right.
Come on. Even though they were slaves, they were being beaten by the taskmasters, they were willing to go back to Egypt just so they know they can, what they thought they was eating better.
Right.
Because they got tired of the manna that they were getting from heaven on a day-to-day basis. Glory to God. People are selling Jesus out for fame, for fortune. People are selling him out, amen, for sexual encounters. People are selling Jesus out for all kinds of stuff. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Jesus is not worth it to them. He's not a pearl of great price. Because they will sell their own soul just for a moment of pleasure. Come on.
Amen.
Are you listening to me?
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
That is going on a day-to-day basis. And the reason why the devil never stops tempting you, because he's looking, amen, for, amen, a price that you're willing to negotiate with him. Get you to sell Jesus out. You heard that term. Everybody has a price. Amen. Well, I come to tell you, that is true with most people, but it better not be true with you. Hallelujah. It better not be true with you. Amen. Are you listening to me? Thank you, Jesus. Jesus is being sold out
The Bible testifies about him in Hebrews chapter 11. Now we know before Moses discovered that he was a Hebrew, he thought that he was an Egyptian. Praise God. He was raised in Pharaoh's house. Glory to God. And God hid him there for an appointed time. But when he found out he was a Hebrew, the Bible says he forsook Egypt. Let's read that. Praise God. In Hebrews chapter 11, let's start reading here at verse 23. It says, by faith Moses, when he was born, he was hid 3 months of his parents, because they saw he was a proper child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandment. Speaking of Pharaoh, he said, by faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Praise God.
Amen.
You see that?
Amen.
Then it says, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Praise God.
Amen.
You see that?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Moses, he forsook Egypt, where he was a prince, where he was a rich man. He had servants. He had everything at his beck and call, but he found something great. Hello?
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
See, until you find Jesus, amen. You're always gonna think something else is better. You're always gonna think something's better than him.
Amen.
But Moses, when he found out who he really was, hallelujah. The Bible says he forsook Egypt, right?
Amen.
He forsook Egypt and all that came with it. And he would rather suffer with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin, which is only for a season. Praise God. Are y'all listening to me? Glory to God. Now, folks, we want you to understand this, because we found out a long time ago that most people have a price. Huh? They have a what? They have a price. Hallelujah. Most people have a price. Are y'all listening to me?
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. And if you offer them the right price, you will set, they will sell Jesus out.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because notice that most people are not selling out completely to follow Jesus.
Amen.
But rather what they do, they are selling him out. Somebody.
Amen.
Blessed be the Lamb of God.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
He's worthy to be praised.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Let's read a couple of more scriptures here. Amen. Amen. Let's go to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16. Amen. I want to start here at verse 24. Matthew chapter 16. Beginning in verse 24, listen to what Jesus said. He said in this text, he said, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me.
Amen.
I wonder how many people have actually done that. Now, in order to be a follower of Jesus Christ, you have to pay attention to the instructions that he gave his own disciples. He said we must do what? Deny ourselves. Glory to God. And then he said we must do what? Take up our cross and come after him.
Amen.
Then he says, for whosoever will save his life shall lose it.
Amen.
See that?
Amen.
And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it.
Now, when people are seeking to save their life in this world, those are people that are unwilling to deny themselves and take up their cross. In other words, their desire is to live after the flesh and enjoy the pleasures of sin. Amen. But if you're going to lose your life for Jesus' sake and the gospel, that's one who's willing to take up their cross and deny themselves and to go after him with their whole heart. How many know you can't serve two masters? You can't be a Christian and yet to steer, amen, up the world. Jesus said, I'm in the world. How many know we still in the world? But Jesus said, I'm not of the world. And we can't be of the world, though we live in this world. He told you, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world, for the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, they are not of the Father, they are of the world, and the world passeth away, but they that do the will of God shall abide forever. Amen. He goes on to tell us here, in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 16, look at verse 26. Jesus said, for what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Look at that. How many know you cannot have Jesus and this wicked world too?
Amen.
You got to forsake this wicked world in order to follow Jesus. You cannot live both. Hallelujah. You got to hate the one and love the other. Hold to one and despise the other. You can't serve God and mammon. Praise God. He said, what does it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? See that? What shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Is that what the book say? Praise God. See, folks, what's happening is the devil has found out that people have an asking price. Amen. And he has got them to sit down at the table where he is negotiating with them. And what do people do? They give in to his tactics and they ultimately sell Jesus out. Now, we like to talk about Judas and what he did. Where you are willing to sell Jesus out. Amen. Judas sold him out for 30 pieces of silver. Esau sold his birthright for a morsel of meat. Well, what is people selling Jesus out for today? Come on. So we got to, when we get down to the nitty gritty, we got to ask ourselves a question. Because we, amen, have found out that many today are repeating the same mistakes that our forefathers have committed. And we're not taking heed to the things that are written in Scripture. The Bible says in Romans 15, the things that are written aforetime, they're written for our learning. And we need to learn from them who have come before us so that we don't make the same mistakes that some of them made. Come on. Praise God. We got to fight the good fight of faith.
and laid hold to eternal life. According to 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 12. Praise God. Does this make sense?
Amen.
Does everybody understand?
Amen.
Praise God. Don't sell Jesus out. Don't sell them out for a moment's of pleasure. Come on. Don't sell them out, praise God, for money. Don't sell them out for fame and fortune. Don't sell them out, praise God, to have your name in lights. Don't you sell Jesus out. Come on. Hallelujah. So the Bible testifies in our foundational scripture that when Esau, who was the twin brother of Jacob, and we know that Esau, even though he was a twin, he was the first one that came out of his mother's womb. Therefore, he received the inheritance. He obtained the birthright. Praise God. And we know it came to a point where Jacob, amen, negotiated with his brother Esau to sell him his birthright. Because again, I'm going to say it again, at that time Esau, who was a great hunter, became very hungry. Hello somebody, are you listening to me? And he was willing to sell his birthright for a morsel of food. Are y'all listening? Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Does this make sense?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
The Bible says that Esau, in Hebrews chapter 12, huh?
Amen.
You know what it says?
Amen.
It says, hallelujah, in verse 17, it says, for you know that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected. Look at that. Why was Esau rejected? Because he sold his birthright. See that?
Amen.
He sold his birthright. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And for that reason, God rejected him.
Right.
Come on.
Amen.
How many know that when God rejects you, that's called reprobation?
Amen.
Come on. You can go back to Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16 through 19 and verse number 30. The Bible shows that when God rejects an individual, that person becomes reprobate. And when a person is reprobate, they are unable to be redeemed. They have gone past the point of no return. That's why the text reads in verse 17, for he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. Why couldn't he find a place of repentance? Because God him, because he sold his birthright.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
And this is why you don't play around. Once God has graciously given you the Holy Ghost, when he has baptized you into the body of Christ, when he has given you the free gift of salvation, that is something that you don't play with. You know why? Because you now have a birthright. You now have in the kingdom of God. Are you listening to me? Somebody bless God.